Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha, Pranam to all. I'm Sriranga Naiki from the International Institute of Vedic Sciences, Rishivatika. We welcome all the enthusiasts of Vedic Sciences and Sanatana Dharma who have joined us live today on the Rishivatika YouTube channel. Let us start today's session with a short prayer. Yontah pravishcha mama vacham imam prasup संजीवयति अखिल शक्ति धरस्वधानम् अन्यांश्च हस्तचरण श्रवणत्वगादीन् प्राणान् नमो भगवते पुरुषाय तुभ्यम्. The topic for today's talk is the Puranas, an introduction and an interpretation, and our speaker is Dr. Ramesh. This is the 73rd talk in the Dr. Vedavyas Memorial online lecture series, which is being conducted by the International Institute of Vedic Sciences, Rishivatika. And it is promoted by Vedavyas Bharati Trust, USKFI, and the Yoga Brotherhood of America, with the blessings of our Pooja Guruji, Dr. Vedavyas. The word Purana literally means ancient or old, and it is a vast genre of Indian literature about a wide range of topics, particularly myths, legends, and other traditional lore. Dr. Ramesh will introduce the Puranas and give us a brief interpretation. Now, let me introduce today's speaker. Dr. Ramesh BM, PhD, is an assistant professor at the Department of Community Health Sciences and Research Associate at the Institute of Global Public Health, Radio Facility of Community Health Sciences, University of Manitoba, Canada. Previously, he was the project director for the University of Manitoba's NNCH projects in Uttar Pradesh and Karnataka. He was also the director of Population Research Center, Dharwad, and a faculty at the International Institute of Population Sciences, Bombay. Dr. Ramesh has been translating the Mahabharata of Maharshi Vedavyasa from Sanskrit to Kannada since 1997 and has been sharing these translations through the website vyasaonline.com. To enhance the understanding of Mahabharata, he has been studying the Puranas with keen interest. Now I request Dr. Ramesh to start his talk on the Puranas.
Thank you, Sri Ranganayake. Namaskar. Hello, everybody. Good morning. Good evening. I'm speaking from Winnipeg, Canada, which is right now it's around 7 a.m. In the morning, and it's about -6 degrees, very cold weather. Let me share my screen. So today's talk is about Puranas, an introduction and interpretation. I wanted to share with you all my own understanding. And of course, my study is very limited of all the Puranas. It's so difficult to, it's such a vast, creations of Vyasa, which is very difficult for one person in their lifetime to go through entirely and make sense out of it. But I started in a very humble way to understand these Puranas. I know it's very difficult, it's a big challenge to understand Puranas, but I thought whatever little things that I have understood with my studies of Puranas, I will share that with you today. I have about 50 or so slides, but I would like to go slowly depending upon your interest in the questions, and I really like you to appreciate the details and the specificity of the Puranas and how they have been composed and how they have been given to us. And even if I am not able to complete the entire talk this time on the topics, we could probably schedule another session. I would like to start with Saraswati Vandana. Saraswati Namastubhyam Varade Kamarupini Vidyarambham Karishyami Siddhir Bhavatu Me Sada. I also would like to pray to Lakshmi Narayana. He is the god of my village where I come from. So Uddhya Aditya Sankasham Pita Vastram Chaturbhujam Shankha Chakra Garapanim Jaye Lakshmi Padim Harim. So I chose five questions to ask, address in this talk, and which generally most of us would be asking these questions in relation to Puranas. What are they and how old are they? And who created these Puranas and how many Puranas are there? And what do these Puranas tell us? So these questions are basic questions that we would like to know about Puranas when we talk about Puranas. So I'm attempting to answer some of these questions, and that's how I started looking at Puranas. What do Puranas themselves say about Puranas? We don't probably need to go beyond Puranas to understand what Puranas are. Puranas themselves, they are self-sufficient. They are able to describe themselves. So let's see what Puranas talk about themselves. Then how old are the Puranas? Now, this is a very difficult question to ask or even answer these questions. So we may have to go a little deeper into the meaning of time and dharma as they are told in Puranas to understand how old are these Puranas. Then the question about who created the Puranas. We all know that Vyasa created the Puranas. So let's understand who is Vyasa and who are Vyasas, as it is mentioned in the Puranas. And how many Puranas are there and what do Puranas contain? So as I was saying before, that I like to go a little slow on these questions and then do not want to rush. And in case we are not able to cover all the topics today, we could probably schedule another session later on. So let's take the first question: what are the Puranas and what do Puranas themselves say? So the Sanskrit word Puran literally means ancient or old. Puranam Akhyanam. So it's an old legend. Vayu Puran says that it's called Purana because it lives in the past, or it breathes ancient times. Yasmat Pura Henatidam Puranam Tena Tasmritam. According to Brahmanda Purana, it is so called since it existed in olden times. Yasmat Pura Yavuchetat Puranam Tena Tasmritam. So different Puranas have given different definitions. So I thought of taking one Puran, Matsya Puran, which talks in detail about the Puranas. So according to Matsya Puran, Narayana himself, in the form of a fish, at the beginning of Vaivaswata Manvantara, which is the current Manvantara, instructed Vaivaswata Manu, the first man of this Manvantara, about the Puranas. So let's see what Matsya had to say. So Matsya says that before all the Shastras, Brahma first remembered the Purana. Puranam sarva shastranam prathamam brahmana smritam. Anantaram cha vaktrebhyo vedastasya vinirgataha. So which means that only after he remembered the Puranas, the Vedas came forth from his mouths. So at the beginning of the Kalpa, there was only one Purana, which was expanded to 100 crore verses. So it's such a vast Purana was one, and it had such a vast number of verses in it. So this again, this means that, you see, when you are defining when you are saying what a Purana is, Matsya is also bringing in many other concepts, right, in this. Brahma is a concept. And he had four faces. Kalpa is another thing that it's a huge concept which we need to understand. What do we mean by beginning of Kalpa? So for Matsya, Vaivasvata Manu was supposed to have, he was a king, and he was supposed to have known, understood whatever these words Matsya is talking about. But for now, in this yuga, most of us probably are, you know, have difficulty in making a complete understanding of these slokas, right? So Trivarga Sadhanam is another one, right? So he says that Purana is something like a Trivarga Sadhana, means it's a means to achieve some of our life goals. So Matsya is saying that Brahma remembered for the first time when he woke up, and whatever he remembered is Purana. And he says that at the end of previous Kalpa, which means that Kalpa is a time period, right? So it comes one after the other. So the previous Kalpa, when it ended, the world was burning. And at that time, in the form of a horse, Vishnu sheltered the four Vedas along with his branches, Purana, Nyaya, Mimamsa, Dharma Shastras, in the form of a horse. So he is Hayashira or Hayagriva. So that was before the beginning of this Kalpa. So at the beginning of this Kalpa, in the form of a fish, residing in the water, which was the only one, I mean, this Ekarna, it is called Ekarna because everything was water, there was nothing else. Vishnu, in the form of a fish, recited all of this again. Hearing this, Brahma woke up and instructed the same to Munis and Devas. So this gives us a sense of Puranas are as old as the universe itself. When the creator wakes up, the things that he remembers first are the Puranas. So Puranas are what he had experienced as a creator and as a person who's witnessing all of this. He's remembering the previous Kalpas. So that's his, that's the Purana. So from this Purana, Matsya Purana says again that all other Shastras were developed from the Purana, from the one Purana, one body of knowledge that we had at the beginning of the Kalpa. So with the passage of time, seeing that the humans are not able to grasp the Purana, Vishnu, taking the form of Vyasa in every Mahayuga and in every Dwapara Yuga, he reduces this one Purana of 100 crore shlokas into 4 lakh verses. So he is abridging the entire Purana. So on the earth, these will be known as 18. However, in Devaloka, Purana is still one with the expanse of 100 crore verses. Now, this is again a very, these shlokas again are bringing in many of the concepts which at that time probably was taken for granted that people understood whatever we are talking about. But, you know, now for us, it's very difficult to comprehend fully what all these concepts are. So what it's telling is that with the passage of time, the humans are not able to grasp the Puranas. So this concept is very important for us to understand. Why are we talking about time here? And why do we think that humans at one time were capable of holding all this 100 crore verses Purana in an understanding? And as the time goes, the humans were not able to grasp the Purana, right? So this is this concept of with the time, something happens. So that we need to keep in mind. We will talk about that a little later. And it's also talking about Dwapara Yuga and Mahayuga. So this is also something which we need to give some attention, get some more details about this. What is a Mahayuga? What is Dwapara Yuga? Which Yuga we are in? Which Manvantara we are in? Which Kalpa we are in? So these are some of the questions that we need to ask, understand. It's also talking about Devaloka. So which means that this, the humans, what we are talking about, we live in a different plane, existential plane, and the devas live in a different existential plane. So we need to understand, so the loka concept also is a Purana concept. So I may not be able to deal with that now, but eventually we should probably get there as well. So Matsya Puran says that, yeah, this Purana is a vast one. This is the first one that the Brahma remembered at the beginning of the Kalpa, which is the beginning of this creation. And every Dwapara Yuga, Vishnu comes in the form of Vyasa, and he abridges the Puranas and makes it into 18. So one is divided into 18, along with the Vedas that he has been dividing. So I'll pause here. And Srirangananki, if there are any questions or something which we could, I could take it up, that would be great. Thank you.
There are no questions at this moment. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So I'll proceed then. So how old are these Puranas? For that, we got some idea about it in the Matsya Puran. So we want to understand more details about how old are they and the concept of time and dharma in the Puranas. So in this section, we will talk about the wheel of time. So Kala Chakra is something that keeps moving incessantly without any stop. And these Kala Chakras have their own measurements, right? So there are Manvantaras, there's Kalpa, there are Yugas. So I'm just trying to describe how time is dealt with in Puranas, and how are time and dharma, how they are related. This again comes from the previous one, which I was talking about, Matsya saying that as the time passes, humans are not able to comprehend the Puranas as one. So that means that with time, something else is changing. And so so Puranas treat this as dharma is also changing with the time. And it's a wheel in the sense that it is cyclical, as against being linear. You see, we think that time is linear. Currently, our understanding is that, yeah, time is like past, present, future. So it just, you know, goes on and on. And the past never comes back, kind of a thing. But in the long-term view of Puranas, both time and dharma are considered cyclical. That means that they keep repeating, right? So they are coming again and again. They're like seasons. We'll talk about that a bit later, what do they mean, what we mean by cyclical in nature. And both are considered to depend on the movement of heavenly bodies. So like the stars, constellations, and the planet, solar system, and Milky Way, whatever we know now of the heavenly bodies. So with the movement, their movements determines the time and dharma. And the assumption was that at the beginning of each cycle, all these heavenly bodies are having a general conjunction at 0 degree longitude. So this also, I'm sure people with astrology, astronomy, cosmology, so they all would be interested in looking at this and seeing how the universe, the heavenly bodies, how their movements are related to the Puranic concept of time. And one cycle of dharma lasts about 4.32 million human years, which equals the role of four yugas. They're called Chaturyuga or Mahayuga. So four yugas from Krita to Kali, they form one dharma cycle, and that lasts about 4.32 million human years. I'm talking about human years again because the measurement of time is relative to your space, right? In which loka you are in. So for human, for Bhuloka, this is the measurement. But for devas and for pitrus, they are having a different measurement. So the traditional Puranic model of time It consists of four major cycles: yugas, manvantaras, kalpas, and the full life of Brahma. So there are four yugas with decreasing lengths. So Satya Yuga, the most dharmic yuga and the longest yuga. Then comes Treta Yuga, Dwapara Yuga, and Kali Yuga, the least dharmic yuga. So each cycle of four is called a Mahayuga. So with each successive yuga, the world goes into a greater state of decreased dharma. You see the relationship between dharma and time. So every yuga, like from Krita to Treta to Dwapara to Kali, every yuga, turn of the yuga, there is more adharma. Because through each cycle, the earth gets further and further away from the absolute. So this also gives the concept of expansion, right? The universe is expanding and then it gets into absorption again. So this whole idea of expansion and coming back again, so that is the concept which we also seem to know now, that the universe is expanding currently. Within every subsequent yuga, there is less order, cosmic law, and the life expectancy of humans is shortened. So that kind of explains a bit about why Vishnu and Vyasa had to come every Dwapara Yuga to abridge, to divide the, first of all, abridge the Puranas, divide them into 18 parts, or Vedas have to be divided into four parts. So this is because with the pass of yuga, every yuga, the human capacity to understand, comprehend is reducing. So moving from yuga, so 71 Mahayugas, they equal one Manvantara, and 14 Manvantaras equal one Kalpa. So Mahayuga itself is a turn of one cycle of dharma, and so 71 dharma cycles, it equals one Manvantara. And one dharma cycle is 4.32 million human years. Just think about the vastness and the infinity of time. So the life of Brahma is made up of 36,000 kalpas and the same amount of nights. So it's a huge, very incomprehensible measurement of time for us to think of in terms of, so it's like as if it's all infinite, it's always there. 36,000 kalpas, you know, it's a kind of a huge amount of time from the human point of view. So for Brahma, a kalpa is half a day, whereas for humans, it is forever, right? So the speed with which the time moves is also dependent on which yuga you are in and which space. The time and space is very important in the universe. So the four yugas are named after four throws. So they are like a dice game. So in Mahabharata, we know the most important critical event is the Dyuta, right? So there, Yudhishthir and Shakuni, they are throwing dice, and based on what numbers you get, you win or lose. So there are four throws in a dice game. From best to worst, there are Krita, Treta, Dwapara, and Kali. Krita means all the four numbers will come. Treta means only three numbers will come. Dwapara means only two numbers, so Kali. So the best throw is Krita and the worst throw is Kali. So you lose when you're Kali and you use when your throw is Krita. So that's how these yugas are also named, from the same concept of a throw in a dice game. So the original order, dharma, so natural order of things, right? So I was chatting with one of the literary figures in English in the US, Kevin, and he has written a book on the natural order of things. So I asked him whether is this based upon the dharma? Because for me, dharma is basically the natural order of things, how it is supposed to be. So the original order is established in the first stage, which is closer to the absolute, the Krita Yuga, gradually decaying in the three others, the Treta, Dwapara, and Kali. So farthest from the absolute. So when you're expanding, when the universe is expanding like this, so you are going away, further and further away from the absolute. So your capacity to understand, also is reducing because you are moving away from the absolute. So dharma or time itself will deteriorate with the passing of the yugas because the yugas are successively shorter. We will come to the length of each of the yugas in a couple of slides later. So dharma, depicted in the form of a bull, stood on all four legs during the Krita Yuga. So you see in the picture in the graph there, four legs. So very firmly established in dharma. Later on in the Treta Yuga, it would become three, followed by two in Dwapara Yuga. And in Kali Yuga, it stands on one leg. The beauty of this is that after Kali comes Krita. So it's not linear. It's not linear in the sense that it gets deteriorating further and further into some, absurd low value of dharma. It's not like that. It says that the dharma springs back on its four legs. After the end of Kali Yuga. So the Mahayuga, new Mahayuga starts, new Chaturyuga starts, right? So in that, Krita starts again. So Kali Yuga is, for me, it's very important. We are living in Kali Yuga. This is one of the Kali Yugas of Vaivasvatman Vantar, the 28th Kali Yuga, 28th Mahayuga we are in. And so, there is hope that after Kali Yuga comes Satya Yuga again. It's not like we are going to deteriorate further and further, but we will again be absorbed. We will again reach closer to the absolute in Krita Yuga soon. Soon means again, for humans, it's a long wait. So I'm trying to explain here what each yuga is characterized by. This is again, the Puranas, Mahabharata, they all tell almost the same thing. So I'm struck by the consistency with which all these Puranas and Mahabharata, Ramayana, they all tell the same thing. So in Krita Yuga, which is also called Satya Yuga, so there is a pure state in existence. That's characterized by simplicity, timelessness, and serenity. Can you think of this? These are all the things that we as a, if you're meditation, if you're a yoga person, if you have achieved some of these conditions, our rishis, they were having these characteristics, a pure state of existence. Timelessness, simplicity, serenity. Like I can think of like Ramana Maharshi or, these are the Paramahams, Ramakrishna. These are all the people who probably achieved this. And if everybody in that yuga was experiencing the same, kind of serenity, timelessness, simplicity, and pure state of existence, it was closest era to the absolute. So the virtue is 100% complete. There is no sickness, there is no death, and sins are not in existence. And people are very moral. So this state of bliss lasts the longest of the four yugas. So that's the beauty of this Krita Yuga. And then comes Treta Yuga, where the deterioration of dharma begins. So the cosmic dharma is disturbed. There is a greater separation from the absolute. And things are still mostly pure, even though sin has been introduced and virtue is reduced to 75%. Then comes Dwapara Yuga. So this is marked by an increase of evil and further loss of dharmic balance. Dharma not only decreases, but the deterioration is accelerated. So you're moving faster into deterioration. virtue is decreased by half, and the human lifespan is reduced. So, you know, we hear here that Ram ruled the earth, say, for 30,000 years, Dasharath for, you know, 80,000 years. So they're all said like that in Puranas, right? So, like, for example, Mahabharata, when I was talking about, when I was reading about the Garuda, and so Vinata, Kashyapa's wife, she was pregnant for 500 years or 5,000 years, like that. So, I mean, it for us, yeah, it looks so improbable, but if I read these, the descriptions of the different yugas, and Garuda obviously was the creature who was born in Krita Yuga. So that makes sense. 500 years, 5,000 years, 40,000 years, it all makes sense, because when you're talking about time, we need to also think in terms of which yuga you were in, because the measurement of time, the speed with which, or the perception of time, that varies by yuga. So in Kali Yuga, we say that Kali Yuga started with the soon after Mahabharata war and the death of Krishna. This comes again and again in many Puranas, the whole concept of Mahabharata war, and when Krishna leaves this earth, that's the beginning of Kali. In fact, the Bhagavata Purana again starts with this premise. So in this Kali Yuga, social order is broken down, and there is a need for royal authority to keep rules and dharma intact. So here, you know, I'm struck by the idea that government is so important in keeping the social order, keeping it from being broken. But again, you know, in Kali Yuga, so how it used to be the government in Satya Yuga and how it used to be in Kali Yuga, I mean, it's an interesting thing to look at. We should probably discuss this some other time. So the ruled question the authority in Kali Yuga, confusing and corrupting the social order. There is an increase of human death. Time goes by a rapid pace. So for us, the days go like, you know, seconds. It's very fast, moving very fast. So these are the descriptions of the yugas, which are told by Puranas and Itihasas for us. And I think I thought that these are amazing insights, knowledge about what the time is in a very absolute sense and relative sense. So Vishnu Puran, which is the Puran told by Parashar. Parashar is the father of Veda Vyas, Krishna Dvaipayan Vyas, and he is telling his disciple Maitreya about the length of each yuga. And he's talking this in terms of divine years. As I was alluding before, that depending upon how fast the time goes and your lifespan and everything, you can feel a day in very different lengths, right? So for example, if I am an ant, for example, my concept of time in a day, I may live only for 5 days, maybe. So a day would be like 1/5 of my existence, right? So it goes like that, that kind of a speed with which the time moves. So for humans, the time moves in a very different speed than to the divine. So the divine means they are all gods. They live in Swargalok. So for that, 12,000 divine years equal one Chatur Yuga or Mahayuga. So that means that Krita, Treta, Dwapara, Kali, all this one cycle of Dharma is 12,000 divine years. You should remember the 12, number 12. So Dwapara and Kali Yugas each have 4, 3, 2, and 1,000 divine years. This again is a very interesting, you know, look at the numbers, how time is measured, it's 12, and then you have 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, they have, so the number, so for example, Krita Yuga will have 4,000 years. Treta will be reduced by 1,000. So it will be 3,000, then 2,000 and 1,000, which is the same as, you know, you remember four legs, 4,000, three legs, you know, 3,000 divine years. Treta means three legs and 3,000 years. So it's very easy for us to remember, you know, these numbers. So that's how the divine years is very easy to remember. Okay, 12,000 year divine years equals one Chatur Yuga or Maha Yuga. And Krita Yuga has 4,000, Treta has 3,000, Dwapara 2,000, Kali 1,000. And before and after each yuga, there will be 4, 3, 2, and 100 years of Sandhya. Sandhya is basically, is the transition time, transition from one, from the daytime to evening. That kind of thing, or early morning or early evening is a Sandhya. So anyway, we should talk about this a little later. I mean, there are a lot of things to talk about in this case, but I think that's sufficient for now to remember that there are about, you know, huge symbolism in this entire measurement. That helps us to kind of remember these calculations very easily. So from Krita to Kali, the duration of each yuga is reduced each time by 1,200 divine years. You see this, the wheel of time. Krita Yuga has 4,800 divine years and 3,600 divine years. So 4,800 includes 4,000 of Krita Yuga and 400 of Sandhya. That is the beginning Sandhya. That's a morning Sandhya. And 400 years of evening Sandhya. Right? So 4,800 divine years. Same thing is with Treta Yuga. 3,000 is the actual Treta Yuga time, but it has got 300 Sandhya in the beginning and 300 Sandhya at the end, towards the end. So like that, we have total, 1,200 divine years. Satya Yuga is four times longer than Kali Yuga. Treta three times. So 8, 4, 2, 1 is another number which comes from this. So one cycle of dharma in divine years observes the usual coefficient of 12 derived from the 12-month year, the unit of creation. I mean, there is a lot of symbolism. There is a lot of things that we need to really think about when it comes to time and the measurements. So this is in the form of human years in Bhulok. So each divine year equals 360 human years. So 360 years for us is 1 year for the gods. So 360 being the days in a year. So in terms of human years, one cycle of dharma or time equals 4.32 million years. So as I was saying before, the 71 dharma cycles, such as the yugas, they make one manvantara. This is again from Vishnu Puran. So what happens is that in every manvantara, the saptarishis, devas, and Indra, Manu, they all change. So that means that one set of saptarishis, devas, and Indra, and Manu, they rule one manvantara, which is about 71 Mahayugas, which is about 4.32 million human years. So the Indra, they keep changing every manvantara. Saptarishis change every manvantara. So they are all, these are positions. These are not fixed people. Saptarishis, they keep changing every manvantara. That's how you see one Puran says one set of saptarishis, another Puran says another set of saptarishis. They are not, we should not consider that, they have missed. They are lying, or they are telling some untruths. No, and they're inconsistent. No, they are consistent. They are talking about that these saptarishis are different in different manvantaras, and devas are also different, and Indra is different, and Manu, of course, is very different in every manvantara. So 1,000 Mahayuga cycles make one kalpa. So 14 manvantaras make one kalpa. So 71 Mahayugas make one manvantara, and 14 manvantaras make one kalpa, which is basically around 1,000 Mahayugas. That means they make one kalpa. These 14 manvantaras, they repeat themselves in the same order over and over again, right? So there are only 14, but we saw that 14. So what it means here is that there is a wheel within the wheel in the time measurement. So the four yugas, they are chaturyugas. So when they become 71 times they roll, they turn back to the same position, a manvantara ends. So, and there are only four yugas, right? So they have to repeat themselves. There is no other, so otherwise there would have been 71 into four, yuga names, but no, there are only four yugas and they have to keep repeating themselves. Same thing is manvantara. So though, kalpa is one day of Brahma, but Brahma has many days, many years. We saw that before. So which means that manvantaras also have to repeat themselves. There are not enough manvantaras to, have different manvantaras at different kalpas, on different kalpas. So that's the whole idea, that they keep repeating. They come in the same order over and over again, just like the seasons that we see here, spring and then come summer and then fall and then winter. It's the same stuff, goes on and on and on. So one cycle of these 14 manvantaras make the daytime of a day of Brahma. Brahma's night lasts as long as the daytime. So Brahma's one day is called a kalpa, which is about 259.2 billion human years. So there are 30 kalpas covering a month of Brahma. I'm just trying to go a little fast so that I would be able to complete at least the section on time and dharma today. So when we talk about manvantara, so each manvantara is ruled by one manu. Each manu has distinct groups of sages, gods, Indra, and so on to help him in its duties. Manus are of Kshatriya class, they are Kshatriya. So it's very important for us to understand the Varna Ashrama Dharma, right? So they are all, so that's interesting to look at that some other time. So when you talk about, when you say Kshatriya, so they have their own dharmas, which is very important. So these Manus are all, they all are of Kshatriya class and are the father to the human race. So Vishnu Puran lists each Manu of the Manvantaras of the present Kalpa by name. And some of these names are different in other different Puranas. Again, depends upon the Kalpa, right? So then the Manu of our present Manvantara is Vaivasvata. So the Matsya Avatar, as described in Mahabharata and in Matsya Puran, they all say that this Matsya Avatar happened in the beginning of this Manvantara, Vaivasvata Manvantara. So there are 14 Manvantaras, Manus, they come there. This is in Vishnu Puran again. Swayambhuva, Swarochisha, Uttama, Tamasa, Raivata, Chakshasha, Vaivasvata. So we are in the seventh Manvantara. And then there will be other seven more Manvantaras which will come. Savarni, Daksha Savarni, Brahma Savarni, Dharma Savarni, Rudra Savarni, Rauchya, and Bhauma. These names are slightly different in different Puranas, but then we should not get disturbed because as we saw that the same person in Puranas and in Mahabharata, they are called by different names. Then there is this concept of Laya, Pralaya, and Mahapralaya. When we are talking about time, so when we say times change, what happens during when the time changes? So the whole idea is that the creation gets dissolved and then the new process starts again. That's the whole idea of creation, laya, pralaya, and the whole idea of time as a cyclical thing. It's just like your seasons, right? So it looks as if everything is gone, but in spring, everything comes out, comes up again from winter. So the process of dissolution is complicated because there will be several dissolutions before the universe is completely dissolved. So so here the concept of loka is very important because there are partial dissolutions and there are simple dissolutions. Then there are pralayas, complete dissolutions, mahapralaya. So this is important to understand if we need to understand the meaning of time. So what it says here is that creation lasts a day of Brahma equal to the age of 14 manvantaras or a kalpa. So 14 manvantaras form a kalpa, which is the daytime. So at the end of each manvantara, there occurs a partial dissolution, which means that only certain lokas, they get dissolved. So there are 14 lokas, and we will talk about lokas some other time, but we don't have a lot of time now today. But this is the idea that there are 14 lokas, and only certain lokas, they get dissolved at the end of a manvantara. And after 14 manvantaras, there will be a great dissolution, mahapralaya. Pralaya happens and then comes the mahapralaya. So we could talk about this so in more detail some other time. So I took this shloka from Mahabharata basically to say how time is perceived as cyclical and how it repeats like seasons. So yadidam drishyate kinchit bhutam sthavara jangamam puna sankshipyate sarvam jagat prapte yugakshaya. So all that is seen in this world, the moving and the non-moving, become one at the end of time, right? All that is seen at the beginning of time gets destroyed at its end, similar to the characteristic features of a season at its beginning and with that season. So thus in this world of no beginning and end, the wheel of birth and death turns eternally. So anadi nidhanam loke chakram samparivartate. This is the summary of what is viewed as time in the Puranas. We need to again, I mean, there's another concept that's coming in here, time and destiny. So Puranas and the Itihasas, they also talk about how time and destiny are linked, are related. So there is a conversation between Janaka and Ashma in Mahabharata. This was narrated by Vyasa to Yudhishthira when Yudhishthira wanted to take out his life after, thinking that he is the cause of death of all the Kshatriya clan in the Mahabharata war. So this appears in Shanti Parva. So what this one is saying that, the Jara Mrityu, old age, death, like a pair of wolves, they devour all creatures, strong or weak, short or tall, no matter who you are, no man can escape old age and death. Not even the subjugator of the whole earth by the sea, in the sense that even a chakravarti, even the most powerful person cannot conquer this old age and death. So be it happiness or be it sorrow that comes upon creatures, it should be enjoyed or borne without elation or depression. So it should be experienced. Not to be elated about or not to get depressed about. There is no method of escape from them. So the birth of creatures and their death and the accessions of gain and loss, they're all preordained. Even as much as, you know, how much I smell, how much what I see, what I taste, what I touch, they all are preordained, ordained in the sense that, you know, where I'm sitting, where you're listening to these, all of these things today, we're talking about these Puranas, they're all kind of preordained, right? So they're all preordained according to the time's course. So when we talk about time repeating itself and it is cyclical in nature, every season comes one after the other. Like I was just thinking about the grass that we see every spring. It was there actually in the last spring as well. We just see that it's becoming green and, you know, blossoming. So every time the same thing gets repeated, we get reborn, we experience the same thing, we talk to people, we have relationships, but all of this is governed by time, and that will go away and come back again. So the whole idea is of revival, of recreation, creation, destruction, creation. So this whole cycle keeps going. That's the whole essence of these Puranas. So these Puranas give 30 kalpas. So each of them have a name, right? So because we want to show that there are only 30 kalpas, there are not many kalpas, but they keep repeating themselves. So currently we are in Shweta Varaha Kalpa. I mean, these kalpa, the names of these kalpas, if you remember, you know, there is in Puranas, they say that if you remember, if you recite these names of 30 kalpas every day, you attain, you know, a status, you attain some boons. So which means that, you know, they have facilitated for us to keep remembering. I remember as a child, we used to remember all the tithis, varas, nakshatras, samvatsaras. We was a bipata, you know, in Kannada, we used to call that. Every, you know, evening, every child in the household, we were asked to recite all these names. Just like how you used to do tables, number tables, like this. So, I mean, it's important for us to remember these kalpa names as well. So I stop here. And if you have any questions, so Sri Ranganayake, please let me know. And then we'll probably cover the remaining topics maybe in the next session.
Yes, we have a question from the audience. Srinivas Ji is asking, nowadays there's a lot of research in the Western world on exoplanets. So they just want to understand how can we correlate these exoplanets to lokas as mentioned in the Puranas.
Yeah, so I mean, thank you so much for this question. I think this is an interesting, very important question to kind of, think about, address. So I was talking to my daughter. We keep discussing these things. She's a software engineer and she left India at the age of 17. So when I talk about these things, she asks the same question, and she's an engineer and she is scientist as well. So she talks a lot about quantum physics and, relativity and string theory. And now she's also multiple universes, right? So you have, it's not one universe, multiple universes. The science is now talking about them, about multiple universes. So so the concept of loka is very important, relevant. And I think that somehow I feel that our science is also going towards the same way eventually to leading us to Satya Yuga, because every time a knowledge needs to be renewed, it cannot be a dead knowledge. Knowledge, if it doesn't grow, then yeah, you know, it's not very useful. So I think the Puranas, what they were saying, we are rediscovering them every time, every Yuga, every Kali Yuga, I think is a time where we rediscover, and then it leads to Satya Yuga. So my concept, just to shorten my answer, is that yes, multiple universes, probably our science will eventually tell us the same things as the Puranas have been telling all along. I hope that answers my question. your question.
Yes, thank you. And one more question. You were mentioning about how the Dharma reduces throughout the Yugas, and we have just, one leg standing in the last Yuga, and it goes back to Satya Yuga. So during this time period, how do you think this happens? Is it because we have another avatar, or how is the Dharma restored?
Absolutely. This is another question again. So these Puranas, they also tell us about the avatar of Vishnu in Kali Yuga, like Kalki avatar. So they have been, almost all Puranas talk about Kalki avatar, and Bhavishya Puran is also talking about how, it's possible that at the end of Kali Yuga and the beginning of Krita Yuga, so Kalki is the one who will come and, establish Satya Yuga again. There will be an avatar. That's what the Puranas tell us. And if we believe whatever they are saying so far, it looks, in terms of the concepts and everything, they look very plausible to me, and they look very realistic. So for me, I hope, and I'm sure that this is going to happen. Kalki is to come in, will come in. But again, it's such a huge time span, right? So we are in the first quarter of Kali Yuga. So to get Kalki, to wait for Kalki, I think it's long, long, long shot for us. I mean, for us now, maybe in another, 100, 200 generations, maybe you may find Kalki. So that may become realistic, right? So right now it looks totally unrealistic because we are so far away from the event that is supposed to happen.
Okay, thank you. You may continue with how the Puranas, how many Puranas are there?
Okay, thank you. Just let me know when I need to close, because just 3 minutes left, right?
Sure. I think you can have a couple more minutes. That's...
Yeah. So how many Puranas are there? Let me try to answer that. So Vishnu Puran gives us 18 names of 18 Puranas. So it's also kind of giving us the order in which the Puranas are there, like Brahma Puran, Padma Puran, Vishnu, Shiva, Bhagavat, Naradiya, Markandeya, Agni, Bhavishya, Brahma Vaivarta, Linga, Varaha, Skanda. So these are all 18 Puranas, right? And then Matsya Puran says that the 18 Puranas, they're talking about different kalpas. So, and the Matsya Puran also gives the number of shlokas in each Purana that's supposed to be there, totaling about 400,000 shlokas, which is similar to what we saw in the previous slides, that Vyasa has come and reduced this 100 crore shlokas into 4 lakh shlokas. So that is the that's what this is about. So like Vaman Puran was in Kaurma Kalpa, Skanda was in Maheshwar Kalpa, Garuda Puran was in Garuda Kalpa. So which means that in each kalpa, whatever the differences of experiences of the universes have been, there seem to be a record of those kalpas. It looks like each Purana is talking about a kalpa. Bhavishya Puran gives a list of other 18 Puranas. So there is a small difference in terms of the names of the Puranas. We can talk about that a little later. There is also supposed to be 18 Upapuranas. So totally there are about 36 Puranas that we talk about. So I stop here, and probably the other two questions that we talked about, like who created the Puranas and what the Puranas contain, tell us. We could probably cover that in the next session. Just to summarize, what we kind of saw is that what is a Purana? So Purana, for me, it looks like it's an abridged encapsulated version of a record of the universe, right? So it's basically a history of a record of, you know, what happened in the universe. That's what Purana is. And how old is Purana? Purana is as old as the universe itself is and the creation is. So that I hope, I hope I have tried to answer those questions to your satisfaction. So thank you very much. If there are any questions, I will take it up. And I would like to thank Gadadhar Ji and all the staff and faculty of the International Institute of Vedic Sciences for giving me this opportunity. And I hope to come back. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the talk on the Puranas. And it was really interesting. And the concept of time was extremely vast. And I'm sure a lot of folks in the audience would agree that it was quite incomprehensible when you're talking about 4.2 million years and things like that. Thank you very much for giving us this quite enlightening talk. And we will conclude today's session with a small announcement with the upcoming talk, which will be tomorrow by Dr. Ruru Kumar. And do join us for all the exciting upcoming talks. We would like to conclude today's session by thanking all the audience who have joined us live, on the Rishi Vatika YouTube channel. And we request everyone to subscribe to the channel for the latest updates and the future talks as part of the Dr. Vedavyas Memorial online lecture series. Now I take your leave. Namaste. Please